Welcome. My name is Lynette Roth, and I'm the Daimler curator of the Busch-Reisinger Museum and the head of the Division of Modern and Contemporary Art here at the Harvard Art Museums. And I want to thank you all for joining us for this week's session of our Art Talks Live, which take place on Zoom every other Tuesday at 12:30 p.m. and offer short interactive talks about the collections of the Harvard Art Museums. And before we begin today's program, the Harvard Art Museums acknowledge that Harvard University is situated on the traditional and ancestral territory of the Massachusetts people, and we at the university strive to honor this relationship. And you can see now in the chat, Bridget has added a link to a digital collection that our Ho family student guides have put together that includes works at the museums that speak to the Native American experience. So please do check that out. Just some logistics before we begin. You'll see them on the screen. This is a webinar format, you can enter any questions or comments that you have into the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. We're going to talk for about 15, 20 minutes or so, and the remainder of the time will be for your questions, and we will conclude the talk promptly at 1 p.m. So today's talk is inspired by ReFrame. ReFrame is a museum-wide initiative at the Harvard Art Museums to reimagine the function, role, and future of the university art museums. And these talks examine difficult histories, foreground untold stories, and experiment with new approaches to the collection of the Harvard Art Museums, reflecting the concerns of our world today. And actually, this is where I typically turn things over as our moderator to the speaker. But today we're really mixing things up because I am both moderator and speaker, because we are inspired today by our Instagram for the Busch-Reisinger Museum and have invited a special guest to join us for today's conversation, which you can also check out on our Instagram every month on @BushHall. And Bridget has added that name of the profile to the chat as well. So check out our monthly conversations on that platform with curators, scholars, artists, and students on issues of art and identity. And so today, after that lengthy introduction, I'm pleased to welcome artist Hans-Christian Schink. Welcome, Hans-Christian.
Hello to everyone.
Thank you. So just a brief introduction of Hans-Christian and his work. He was born in Erfurt in 1961 and studied photography from 1986 to 1991 at the Academy of Visual Arts in Leipzig and earned his master's degree there in 1993. And Hans-Christian has had solo exhibitions of his work at the Photo Forum Innsbruck in Austria, the Kunsthalle Erfurt, actually that was earlier this year, the Saarland Museum Saarbrücken, the Museum Kuppersmühle in Duisburg, the Neues Museum in Weimar, Martin Gropiusbau in Berlin, and many, many others. And we're very pleased to welcome you today to Art Talks Live, because as you know, Hans-Christian, this entire event was inspired actually by the recent acquisition of your large scale photograph, which is called A38 in German, Schkortleben Bridge number one. And it is part of a series of Hans-Christian's work dating from 1995 to 2003 called Traffic Projects German Unity. And the photos track the high-speed rail system in Germany, and as in our photograph, also the concrete pillars for the German highway system known as the Autobahn. So Hans-Christian, I was hoping we could just spend a little bit of time here at the outset looking at the photograph that's now in our collection and talking a little bit about your interest in this motif and your inspiration.
Yeah, the whole series started in the mid 90s. At that time, I was interested in all the different aspects of the changes in my environment. especially in suburban structures and also in aspects that the land that affected the landscape. Because, you know, in East Germany, we didn't have suburban structures. So this kind of environmental progress was completely new to me. And as I said, in the mid 90s, I was interested in all these things that popped up literally after the reunification. So that was, yeah, this is one of the early, this is an early series from Leipzig to Güntersdorf. And this road was a highway leading out of Leipzig. And within a few years, there was a lineup of supermarkets, car dealers, gas station, fast food restaurants. And what you can see in the background is a shopping mall. At that time, it was the biggest shopping mall in Germany, opened in 91. So really quick after the reunification. And so while working on, or while looking for all these different aspects, in 95, I found an image of a, so I took an image of a, now this is one of the other aspects, the industrial parks and shopping, as I said, shopping malls. And for this, I was always traveling around looking for objects like this.
So this is a fence, this is a, or it's, no,
it's a... It's a wall of a kind of a Home Depot market.
Ah, uh-huh. Right, so much of it a reaction to the kind of construction boom after reunification.
Right, right. And in 95, I found an image of the Autobahn bridge from underneath. So at that time, it was part of collection of images of all these different aspects. But 2 years later, on a weekend trip, I came across this place. And it's a construction site of another Autobahn. And seeing this, I realized the Autobahn, the traffic projects, could be a project on its own. So, and then I started to do research. And I found out, well, it was known to us all that, yeah, this is a project inspired by the German government to bring East Germany to the same level of infrastructure like West Germany.
Right, so what we're looking at here, just for our audience, is basically the plan of the map of railways and highways and also waterways that was part of a federal initiative in 1991 to sort of literally unite East and West Germany. And actually, Matthias Pfluge, who's written quite beautifully on your work in the past, referred to this idea, this traffic projects, as it was called, as the vision of German unity poured in concrete. And I like that very much because it is this kind of literal physical manifestation of, you know, what was sort of hoped for also with German reunification.
Yeah, I think this is one point of view. This is something that is that refers more to the political aspect. But there was another important aspect to me personally. You have to imagine I didn't have a car all the East German times. My parents didn't have a car. We used to travel by train, so it was a slow life. And sometimes we traveled to the Baltic Sea with my uncle on it. And it took us 8 hours to get there using country roads. So the traffic projects, in a way, were also progress for me. My view of the landscape changed a lot. So the speed I was traveling changed a lot. And so working on this project was a time of complete ambiguity, because it was a matter of gain and loss.
Yeah.
I saw the landscape I grew up in changing a lot. And on the other hand, I couldn't make use of all the new structures. So this is what's underlying in this project of my personal history.
I think it's so interesting that you said that, because, you know, really when we think about the Autobahn, we think about speed, right? And yet sort of everything about your photographs, for me, doesn't speak to speed, right? We don't actually see cars. We don't see people. We don't see, I mean, when you first said the word progress, I was sort of nagging in the back of my mind, does he think it's progress in a positive way? Or, you know, because obviously for you, the landscape, you know, as we see in our photograph of the Schkortleben Bridge, you know, is completely dominated from the perspective you give us by this pylon. And yet there's this small little road that goes around it, heading towards what looks like, you know, a farmstead or a small group of buildings. But that's not the road. That's not the fast road. That's the road, I guess, you used to take.
Yeah, I mean, this, actually, this project isn't really about the Autobahn. It's about landscape. And it's not about nature versus civilization, which a lot of people think in the first moment, but it's a matter of different cultures, of different use of the land. I mean, this is all cultural land. So, and there is a structure that was built over the ages, and then another structure was put on top of it.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe this is another ambiguity, let's say. Mm-hmm.
So it seems like you don't see it sort of completely critically, or as progress in a positive sense, but you're kind of sort of literally stuck in the middle of that as
right.
Yeah.
I mean, it's impossible to step aside and say I see it completely critically while using it. I hope that people will see the ambivalence or the ambiguity in the images, but I'm not in a position to be just critical.
Mm-hmm. How long does it take to get to the Baltic Sea now using the new Autobahn?
5 hours.
Well, it's not that much faster. Well, it was interesting because as I was looking at the works in the series, you know, I didn't recognize any of the names, and you're very specific in the titles about, you know, which Autobahn are we looking at, or which train, you know, fast train rail track are we looking at? And so I just put a couple of them into Google Maps, Schkortleben, which is where our photograph was taken, Molsdorf, Nauendorf, you know, and it then of course becomes clear that these are all places outside of major urban centers, which, you know, resonates with what you were saying about what you were interested in about how the boom was happening also outside of those big cities. We can see here it's sort of, you know, outside of Leipzig, and that's where, you know, these photographs were taken. And it does seem like it's the place to me where the Autobahn whizzes past people, right? So, you know, how far do they even have to go or how far do they have to go to get on that fast train station track? I mean, those debates are in the United States as well, right? Everybody wants a fast train, but they don't want it to be loud, and they don't want it to impact, you know, something in near them, but they also want to have access to it. So, you know, these, again, this, what you were calling kind of ambiguity or ambivalence.
This is a bit different from the US. The train tracks, they go right through these cities. The Autobahn system isn't. So it passes, and you have to go a few miles to get on the Autobahn. But you don't have, like Los Angeles or any other mega city in the US, except for Berlin, you don't have Autobahns within the city.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to look back again at this photograph because, you know, for me, I was thinking about the fact that you now live in Mecklenburg-Vorpommern, which, you know, for our audience is, you know, sort of rural, more rural area outside of Berlin. So it does feel, at least now, that you've in some ways kind of chosen to live in the landscape or in those spaces that maybe are less touched by this infrastructure in such a dramatic way, or am I just projecting that?
No, that's correct. But I mean, I finished the traffic project series in 2003. So a lot of things happened. I traveled extensively all over the world. And now I ended up in the very remote place, in a village with 53 people. So, it's a different life. And in a way, it's also caused by all the experience of what happened to our landscape, to our environment. I'm in a position to do that. A lot of mm-hmm. people aren't.
Yeah. This is actually an interesting example to also talk a little bit about your process. So there is actually, as this title suggests, it's a sort of number one of two. And so there are actually two photographs that you took of this same bridge, which are, you know, dramatically different. And here, you know, we're really situated underneath and sort of massiveness of the material, you know, and the kind of symmetry of the roadway. So my question would be, because it doesn't seem to happen very often in your work that you have two images of the same motif.
Well, usually I don't have a fixed concept. The project is evolving when I'm working on it. I have a kind of a general idea in the beginning, and then I do a lot of research and I do a lot of traveling. I just go to these places. For example, for the traffic projects, I usually went on the weekends and I had special permission for all the construction sites.
Mm-hmm.
So I try to avoid any human presence in these images. And very often I had to return to the same place because it wasn't the right weather condition.
So and what was that weather condition? Because these images have been referred to as having no weather. And I think, to me, this is just German weather.
It's not the always. Sky, it's yeah. not always. but I was waiting for this because I really love this non-dramatic light, no clouds, no. And especially the color blue in the sky, I feel is kind of lasting on the image. So I try to avoid it.
Hmm. Well, that's interesting. So is this just a case then where, because you don't have a sort of set plan, you just ended up with two photographs of this that you liked, and so both became a part of the series?
I mean, you know, at that time I worked with a large format analog camera, and once I was there on the spot and the weather was right, I was just collecting images. And collecting means for a couple of years. And step by step, I got an idea how the final result, how the final series could look like. But mm-hmm. when it comes to the editing process, sometimes I just find, okay, there are two images of the same place that are worth keeping.
Mm-hmm. So,
as long as they are different enough, and as long as they bring another aspect to the story.
Yeah, and I love actually switching from this to the next image that I had pulled, which is really, you said it's not a series about the Autobahn, so I take that. And I think, you know, actually, this is interesting to look at because it's actually one of the most popular associations with the Autobahn, and that's the electronic music hit by Kraftwerk, and this is a sort of cover from that album. But there are, of course, all sorts of associations with the Autobahn beyond the traffic projects that we've talked about and how you kind of got there. And, you know, one of the major ones is that it was hugely promoted in Nazi propaganda. And also you'd mentioned to me as an East German, one of the images that was most associated with it in the GDR was by Wolfgang Mattheuer, his Beyond the Seven Hills, which we see here, where we're also, again, in most of these images, we actually are situated in the car. We actually are on the roadway, you know, having that sort of vista in front of us, and here a kind of play on Delacroix's Liberty Leading the People. Which brings me back then to the fact that, you know, those are not the perspectives that we get in your work, right? Where sometimes there are a few where we are actually situated, either like the one where we open that it's being built, we're kind of centrally in the highway. And here, though, you know, here we start to get allusions to German romanticism.
Yeah, I mean, it's really an important part of my life because my father was a teacher for art and art history at an academy in Erfurt, and he was a big fan of Caspar David Friedrich.
Ah.
So, of course, this was an important influence to me, and I always say I feel that there's a sediment of images you build up over time. And of course, this is always an influence, even if I'm not aware of.
Hmm.
But in the end, looking at my own pictures, I recognize this influence. It's not that I stand on the spot and say, well, that looks like German Romanticism. But looking at the images in the end, I recall it.
Mm-hmm.
And especially this image, the swan is a typical motif of the Romanticism. And the story about this image is that I went there three times. The first two times, there was too much wind, so the water wasn't calm enough. The third time, I just put up my camera and the swan arrived. I didn't want it to be there. I was away.
I'm not sure everyone can see that, so yeah. Here.
But there was just this moment when I thought, well, okay, let's take a shot. And literally after that shot, it left. And I took the shot without it. And ended up looking at both of the images as well, it's perfect there. So, and it's my reference to German Romanticism, of course.
Yeah, oh, it's really stunning. And I think that's also part of what you get, you know, from the scale of your images, which of course we're not getting a sense of in the Zoom world, but, you know, the scale and the scale that those large negatives allow you to do, because you can actually blow them up quite large. You can see the Schkortleben Bridge number one here in the background.
Yeah, the idea is a bit to give the audience the feeling that one could really step into the landscape, and that also, well, maybe a little bit an effect of overwhelming,
mm-hmm.
which in a way was what I felt on the spot sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah, you really get that sense, I mean, from a number of them, or, you know, there's a real contrast in, you know, something like this one, where it's literally the concrete wall, right, which, you know, we tend to associate concrete wall with Germany's division rather than its unification, where we're completely blocked, our view is blocked, to something like this one, off here near Chemnitz, which really feels like it is actually framing the landscape and, in contrast to others, really inviting us to take it in.
Yeah, I think the whole series is about being these structures part of the landscape. This is also a reason why you usually don't see the road itself. I wasn't that much interested in the view from the car.
Mm-hmm.
I was interested in the view of the landscape, and I was interested in the view, these structures being part of the landscape.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's really helpful, actually, because we tend to think of, you know, the view from the car as also this very individualized, I mean, certainly in the United States, right? It's a symbol of freedom, right? You're in your car, you're on the open road, you know, and the fact that we don't get that from you like we do in the Kraftwerk cover, for example, really situates this in the realm of landscape photography, with all of those cultural, political, and art historical references, which I think are just fascinating. And we could continue to unpack them, I'm sure, for a very long time. I'm aware that we're running out of time. I don't see any questions in the chat just yet. And so while we're maybe are in the Q&A just yet, so while we're waiting, I'm going to ask you a question, and that is the Traffic Projects, the initiative by the federal government that actually inspired your series, or that became a kind of frame for your photographs, is still, from what I read, ongoing and maybe wrapping up in a couple of years. And yet, you know, sort of actually getting everything done that was on that initial map that we showed. And yet you ended your series in 2003. Why is that?
Yeah, I mean, I was aware that I could work on this for 10 or 15 more years. But on the other hand, there was a point when I got the feeling I start to repeat myself.
Mm-hmm.
And the story is told. I couldn't find any places that were that much different and that would add an aspect to the series that I haven't noticed yet. So the moment I felt, okay, now it's getting the same, I thought it's better to stop now. And it was, yeah, I mean, it also in a political sense, it was better to stop at that point because it was at the height of the discussion of what is it worth?
What is what worth, the infrastructure itself?
Yeah, and is it worth spending that much money on it?
Hmm.
Because after a couple of years, people realized there might be little problem with the blooming landscapes that were promised mm-hmm. to us. And then the discussion began. What should we spend all this money for? Because at that time, a lot of autobahns, a lot of these new build projects, they weren't really crowded with cars.
Mm-hmm. Because I was curious, I was wondering too, you know, the distance then from, you know, the initial launch of the project, but then also the sort of sense that one had, you know, more than, you know, 10 years after reunification at that point about, you know, what all this construction meant, right? And we saw the same thing in a boom in cities of, you know, this idea that it was an investment and, you know, people were going to be flocking to these cities that, you know, at least for a certain amount of time, you know, there wasn't that kind of response. So I was curious if it has to do with sort of, in some ways, as we got further away from, you know, the project of German unity, and it became clear actually, you know, that an Autobahn wasn't going to literally connect people.
Yeah, maybe it was kind of naive to bring all this hope that the Autobahn would connect West Europe and with East Europe, and that former East Germany could be the link to Eastern Europe. And at that point, when I finished this project, we were all in the process of disillusion.
Mm-hmm.
And so then the big question was, what's next? A lot of things we were hoping for just didn't happen. I mean, yeah. Of course, a lot of things did happen. I don't want to say that I want to go back to East German times.
Yeah.
Of course not. But yeah. It turned out it's a bit difficult. It's a bit more difficult than Helmut Kohl promised.
Indeed. Well, it's, you know, it's a complex topic. And I think, you know, you've given us an incredible introduction to that. We had two questions in the chat. One was from someone who joined a bit late, who was asking whether the Autobahn pulled the landscape together or separated it. And I think we answered that, and that, you know, for you in some ways it did both, right? It was both, yeah. Both things at once, which led to your own ambivalence about it. And one more question, which I'm not sure I understand, that what has been presented about your work resonated with your own inspiration. I don't know if they mean presented in other contexts or... George, if you want to clarify that for us, but um, No. Okay. Well, I think we'll stop there, Hans-Christian, on the difficult topic of German unity and where we were then and where Germany still is now. And just thank you very much for joining us to talk about this very exciting addition to our collection. And I want to thank everyone at home for joining us as well. And just to remind you that we'll be sending a survey after we're done. And please take the time to fill it out. We appreciate it very much. And we look forward to seeing you in 2 weeks' time for our next Art Talks Live. And you can always find out about all of our events on our website. And of course, the museum is now open to the public. So please make a reservation and bring your proof of vaccination and come and see the collections in person. So thank you again, Hans-Christian, and have a good day, everybody.
Yeah, thank you for having me, and it was my pleasure.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, you're welcome.